Hi, my name is Kate Harrison, and I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with Brett DiNovi & Associates. Today, I'm going to discuss with you E7 of the 4th edition BACB task list, Plan for Behavioral Contrast. So what is a behavioral contrast? Introduced by Reynolds in 1961, the formal definition for behavioral contrast is the phenomenon in which an alteration in one component of a multiple schedule of reinforcement that increases or decreases the rate of responding on that component is accompanied by a change in the response rate in the opposite direction on the other unaltered component of the schedule. Or, to put it simply, an unintended increase or decrease in your target behavior that is opposite of your intervention goal for the same behavior in a different environment. Multiple schedules refer to two or more basic schedules of reinforcement, so think varied and fixed ratio and varied and fixed interval, occurring in alternation and independent of each other. Different discriminative stimuli are associated with each schedule. This is important, so let's break it down into a more manageable and understandable definition based on some of the other components that we already know. Generalization training is incorporated into quality treatment programs and is one of the 7 dimensions of applied behavior analysis. In their 1977 review paper, Stokes and Baer explain that generalization occurs when a trained behavior occurring in the treatment environment occurs across other settings without direct training. In this context, across settings refers to people, places, time, behaviors, and environments. Dissimilarly, Pliskoff and colleagues explained that a behavioral contrast occurs when a change in behavior's reinforcement rate in one context results in behavior change in the opposite direction in another context. Because multiple schedules are always at play, in order to truly plan and train for generalization, we must consider the potential for behavioral contrast. For example, Kevin calls out the answers in both math and reading class.
This is bothering my shoes untied.
And both his math and reading teachers intermittently reinforce this behavior by praising him for his answers. Different classrooms, teachers, and material are examples of controlling discriminative stimuli in this example. One day, Kevin's math teacher has enough and begins to punish his behavior by taking away points for free time minutes.
Who can tell me why Jem cries when the hole in the tree is filled with cement?
Because she's a crybaby?
Get out.
Kevin's reading teacher does not change her intermittent praise. The following week in the teacher's lounge, Kevin's math and reading teachers are catching up. Kevin's math teacher said that she noticed a decrease to almost zero levels for calling out in her class, while Kevin's reading teacher has noticed a significant increase in calling out behaviors surpassing previous levels. What happened here? One, calling out was initially occurring at similar rates on two components of a multiple schedule. Two, responses of one component of the schedule, math class, were punished, while responses on the other component, reading class, continued to go unpunished. Three, the rate of calling out decreased in the punished component, math class, and simultaneously increased in the unpunished component, reading class, even though there had been no increase in reinforcement. In their 2018 discussion paper, Boyle and colleagues point out the substantial amount of research devoted to generalization, while applied research involving behavioral contrast is quite limited, despite both items being deemed necessary skill sets according to the BACB. The authors go on to argue that in order to thoroughly predict and change socially significant behaviors outside the therapy setting, it's important to identify the variables responsible for both generalization and behavioral contrast effects. While Boyle and colleagues note that variables such as changes in reinforcement rate, reinforcement quality, and the presence of alternative activities do influence the degree to which behavioral contrast may occur, the consideration of behavioral contrast occurrence when multiple schedules of reinforcement are at play is an important one, especially when programming for generalization. In the earlier example, a proactive, collaborative approach among teachers may have offered the opportunity to minimize the presence or degree of behavioral contrast. Finally, as good behavioral scientists, parsimony requires us to rule out simple and logical explanations for phenomena under investigation prior to considering more complex explanations. Fluently understanding the concept of behavioral contrast may allow you to approach, investigate, and intervene parsimoniously. Do you and your team consciously consider behavioral contrast? We want to hear from you. Leave a comment below. And if you want to help us spread the science, click the link below in the description box. Thanks for watching.